Well, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. No matter which day it is, no matter what time you're watching, we are so glad that you could be here today as we celebrate Sunday, February 14th, 2021 at the Glen Abbey United Church service of which you are a part of. And may the peace of our risen Lord be with us all. Amongst our announcements, the Social Committee would like to thank those who returned their questionnaires about possible activities, and they've actually extended the deadline so that they can get even more input. So the new deadline will be February 16th, I believe that's Tuesday, and you have an opportunity to send in what you might be interested in so they know where to put their energy and efforts. Secondly, if you do find you have some time and are looking for some low-impact exercise, Ellen Anderson is conducting chair yoga classes, and if you look at the last newsletter, I believe there's information there on how to enroll. Amongst our occasions that we're celebrating, first of all, my own personal belated happy birthday to Donna McNaught, which I messed up on last week, so happy birthday again, Donna. Coming up this week, on February 17th, our great congratulations go out to Tracy and Reynaldo Botello, who are celebrating their 25th anniversary. Congratulations, a silver anniversary. That's something to be proud of. And then lastly, today, February 14th, is Margaret Gardner's birthday, our own Valentine baby, apparently. So we send our best wishes over the miles to Margaret, and we ask Yvonne to please play Happy Birthday so we can all sing to Margaret. During these days when so much is changing, there's so much anxiety, we need this time. We need to put aside things that are bothering us, to put aside the media exposure that we have, to put aside those things that cause us such grave concern. And I invite you to concentrate on the Christ candle, to listen to the music, and to truly prepare our hearts and minds to worship. And we'll begin with the words to the call to worship. Jesus went to the mountain and was transformed. God calls us to change our lives. God calls us to change our hearts. We ask God to transform our lives, our hearts, our thinking. Let us worship God. And we'll begin our worship today with the Transfiguration Hymn, as this is Transfiguration Sunday. It's number 103, and we'll sing verses 1, 2, 3, and 5. How good, Lord, to be here. Yvonne, choir, please.
Oh,
now, let us all join together in the prayer of confession and invocation as we all pray together. God of transfiguration, please have mercy upon us. In your word, you offer guidance, yet we ignore your counsel. Dazzle us anew with the light of love. Forgive us. Restore us. God of power and wonder, we are awestruck by the glory of your presence. We rejoice at what we can see. We marvel at what we cannot see. You dazzle us with your brightness. You strengthen and transform us. May we love and serve you in all that we are and do. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And the good news of the gospel is that God is there for us. God is approachable for us. Not some distant, far-off ruler, but someone who, through the Holy Spirit and the love of Jesus Christ, can help us to be the people that God sees such incredible potential in. And that is truly good news indeed. Oh, get this on here. Hi, Buford.
Hi, Riptide. Happy Valentine's Day.
Oh, same to you, Buford.
Hey, Riptide. What did a strawberry say to a blueberry on Valentine's Day?
I don't know. What did they say, Buford?
I love you very much.
Ha, good one. I'm sure you have more.
What flower gives the most kisses on Valentine's Day?
Tell me, what flower gives the most kisses?
Tulips. Get it? Two lips. I break myself up.
Okay, one more, that's it.
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Arthur.
Arthur who?
Are there any chocolates left for me?
Hey, Buford, what's the best part about Valentine's Day?
I don't know, Rev Ted. What is the best part?
The day after, when all the chocolate goes on sale.
Really? Really? That's the best part?
No, Buford, the real best part is knowing that God loves us so much that we are never alone, and our church family cares so much about us.
Now that sounds more like something you would say. Bye, everybody. See you next week.
Bye, Buford. Our praise song again this morning starts off slowly and really addresses these times that we're in. And then it brings us together in saying, "We believe." It's by the Newsboys, and you can find the link either on the email you received or on the website. Let us bow our heads in prayer, please. Loving God, as we come together on this Transfiguration Sunday, we don't know what you want us to do. We know that there's a word we need to hear from you to help give us clarity and direction. So we ask that today, as we watch and listen, whether it be through the songs or perhaps in the scriptures we're about to hear, let us be able to recognize your word to each of us. Let us take it in, and then let us ponder how we can do something about it. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And today I'd like to invite Catherine Ward for readings from 2 Kings as well as Psalm 50. Catherine, please.
Good morning. Our reading today comes from 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 15. The time came for the Lord to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elijah and Elisha set out from Gilgal, and on the way Elijah said to Elisha, "Now stay here. The Lord has ordered me to go to Bethel." But Elisha answered, "I swear by my loyalty to the living Lord and to you that I will not leave you." So they went on to Bethel. A group of prophets who lived there went to Elisha and asked him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master away from you today?" "Yes, I know," Elisha answered, "but let's not talk about it." Then Elijah said to Elisha, "Now stay here. The Lord has ordered me to go to Jericho." But Elisha answered, "I swear by my loyalty to the living Lord that I will not leave you." So they went on to Jericho. A group of prophets who lived there went to Elisha and asked him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master away from you today?" "Yes, I know," answered Elisha, "but let's not talk about it." Then Elijah said to Elisha, "Now stay here. The Lord has ordered me to go to the Jordan River." But Elisha answered, "I swear by my loyalty to the living Lord and to you that I will not leave you." So they went on, and 50 of the prophets followed them onto the Jordan. Elijah and Elisha stopped by the river, and the 50 prophets stood a short distance away. Then Elijah took off his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. The water divided, and he and Elisha crossed to the other side on dry ground. There, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what you want me to do for you before I am taken away." "Let me receive the share of your power that will make me your successor," Elisha answered. "That is a difficult request to grant," Elijah replied. "But you will receive it if you see me as I am being taken away from you. If you don't see it, you won't receive it." They kept talking as they walked on. Then suddenly a chariot of fire, pulled by horses of fire, came between them, and Elijah was taken up to heaven by a whirlwind. Elisha saw it and cried to Elijah, my father, mighty defender of Israel, you are gone." And he never saw Elijah again. In his grief, Elisha tore his cloak in two. Then he picked up Elijah's cloak that had fallen from him and went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. He struck the water with Elijah's cloak and said, "Where is the Lord, the God of Elijah?" He struck the water again, and it divided, and he walked to the other side. The 50 prophets from Jericho saw him and said, "The power of Elijah is on Elisha." They went to meet him and bowed down before him. Our psalm this morning is number 50, verses 1 through 6. The mighty one, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. Our God comes and does not keep silence. Before him is a devouring fire and a mighty tempest all around him. He calls to the heavens above and to the earth that he may judge his people. Gather to me my faithful ones who made a covenant with me by sacrifice. The heavens declare his righteousness, for God himself is judge. Thanks be to God.
And thank you, Catherine, for your reading of God's word and doing a great job. Our gospel lesson today comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, verses 2 to 9. And again, we listen for God's word as we hear what Mark recorded. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John and led them up a high mountain where they were alone. As they looked on, a change came over Jesus, and his clothes became shining white, whiter than anyone in the world could ever wash them. Then the three disciples saw Elijah and Moses talking with Jesus. Peter spoke up and said to Jesus, "Teacher, how good it is that we are here. We will make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He and the others were so frightened that he did not know what to say. Then a cloud appeared and covered them with its shadow, and a voice came from the cloud, "This is my own dear son. Listen to him." They took a quick look around, but they did not see anyone else. Only Jesus was with them. As they came down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Don't tell anyone what you have seen until the Son of Man has risen from death." Thanks be to God for these holy words. Well, my message today is titled, "Can You Believe It?" Have you ever had anything happen right before you that you could hardly believe your eyes? Well, with the snow that we got, especially in Hamilton on Friday, it reminded me of one Sunday afternoon after my son and I had left Millgrove Church, we had something like that happen. You see, we turned onto Highway 6 and we were headed south, and all of a sudden, I saw a northbound car suddenly coming diagonally into our lanes at full speed. The van that was a couple of seconds in front of us, he hit the brakes, swerved to miss the car that slammed into the snowbank, went up into the air so high that we could see the full undercarriage before it slammed into the snow in the ditch about 3 feet short of a tree. Wow. Even though it was a very upsetting sight, I called 911 to get the OPP and the ambulance there and got out to check on the driver. He got out of his car and was walking around. The driver of the van and his daughter, well, they were really upset, but I managed to get them calmed down, and we waited until the police and ambulance had arrived. It was hard to believe that no one was injured, let alone killed, and in this very close miss, there even appeared to be almost no damage to his car. It wasn't until afterwards we were talking and we realized if someone hadn't needed the door to the church unlocked just as we were leaving, that could have been us trying to avoid a fatal collision. In today's gospel reading, the scene that is known as the Transfiguration is described. And remember, before I mentioned about passages it would be easier to skip, well, this passage is so strange and kind of difficult to understand. It was tempting to just sort of gloss over it and just talk about Valentine's Day. But that would be the easy way out, and that's why we have the common lectionary. So let's do it. It was one of those scenes that was so amazing, anyone might find it hard to believe. We read in Mark 9 that Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, and led them up a high mountain where they were alone. Now, these three disciples, they were Jesus' inner circle and the same three that went to Gethsemane with him. The high mountain is significant because that is where God was usually encountered. Then they're looking on, and this change comes over to Jesus, and his clothes are so shining white. It became so dazzlingly bright, it was like the glare from sunlight on snow or ice, where people go snowblind from. Both Matthew and Luke's account also say that Jesus' face shone like the sun as well. Well, this in itself would be a wondrously strange occurrence, but it's nothing compared to what happens next. We read, "Then the three disciples saw Elijah and Moses talking with Jesus." Not a big deal, except for two important facts. Elijah had lived 850 years before Jesus, and Moses was born 1,200 years before Jesus was born. It would be sort of like me going out and seeing Rick outside, casually talking to Richard the Lionhearted and the Emperor Charlemagne. I'd probably find it hard to believe it. So why would Jesus be talking to Moses and Elijah specifically? While the Hebrew people often referred to their scriptures, what we call the Old Testament, as the Law and the Prophets, Moses, he was the highly revered author of the Law and one of the real fathers of the Jewish faith. Elijah was revered as one of the most important prophets. Our Old Testament lesson today that Catherine read so well says that he was taken up to heaven, and it was written in Malachi that Elijah would appear again before the Messiah would be revealed. Now, at that time, a lot of people were afraid that Jesus' radical new teachings were designed to abolish the scriptures, the ones they were raised on, the ones they knew and loved. But Jesus said in Matthew 5:17, he said, "Do not think that I have come to do away with the law of Moses and the teaching of the prophets. I have not come to do away with them, but to make their teachings come true." So it made perfect sense that Jesus would be with Moses and Elijah before the next phase of his ministry was to begin. Well, Peter evidently believes as he says, "I'm glad I was here. Now let's get some tents set up for these three." Providing shelter for these travelers, that seems like a very pragmatic and sensible thing to do. And I think it speaks volumes for verifying what he was seeing. If you thought for an instant that what you saw wasn't really happening, you wouldn't even consider making a tent. Much like if I had had any doubt about the car accident being real, I wouldn't have called 911. They both were sensible reactions to extraordinary occurrences. Just then, a cloud appeared and covered them with its shadow, and a voice came from the cloud. "This is my own dear son. Listen to him." They took a quick look around, but did not see anyone else. Only Jesus was with them. Well, the sudden appearance of the cloud, that would have clued the disciples in that God was present and speaking to them. Because it was in a pillar of cloud that God led Moses and the Israelites out of Egypt. It was in the cloud that God came to the tabernacle. It was the cloud that filled the temple after Solomon had finished having it built. And it was descending on clouds that would be the arrival of the Messiah. These are all images that Jewish people would have been very, very familiar with. And likewise, all the familiar symbols of God's glory were present that day. They were on a high mountain. There were shiny garments. Two of the Bible's most famous patriarchs were there. And there was a shadowing cloud and a voice from heaven. Doesn't get much better than that. Now, it's interesting to note, when God spoke at Jesus' baptism in the Jordan, it was directed only to him. But in this instant, the message was for the disciples. "This is my own dear son. Listen to him." They had grown up listening to the words of Moses and prophets like Elijah. Now it was time to listen to Jesus. Now, this was when the real transfiguration took place, not just in Jesus' appearance and clothing, but in his glorious role that he would play in this world. At this moment, God revealed Jesus' true nature in the same way that Jesus would reveal God's true nature to humans, including us. Up until this point, the disciples had thought of Jesus as a really talented teacher and a miracle worker, but they didn't understand what he was talking about a lot of the time, especially as he had just started speaking about going to Jerusalem to be killed and then rise again. That was such a bizarre notion and so contrary to the image of the Messiah that they had been taught all their lives. They weren't able to process that information. But now they realize that Jesus was so much more than just a great human being. He was God in the flesh. This revelation would give them something to cling to when they were in the wake of the crucifixion. Martin Luther, the 16th century Protestant reformer for which Martin Luther King Jr. was named, said, "I am well satisfied with the gift of the Holy Scriptures, which gives me abundant instruction and all that I need to know, both for this life and for that which is to come." Now, not everyone reads the Bible, so God found other ways to reveal the glory. And the same Martin Luther also later said, "God writes the gospel not in the Bible alone, but on trees and flowers and clouds and stars." The scriptures reveal Christ to us in all his glory, but God wasn't satisfied to leave it at that. God wanted to give us every possible opportunity to see the glory of Christ. So he surrounded us with what the old hymn calls all things bright and beautiful, trees and flowers and clouds and stars. As you may know, we have fractional ownership of a cabin in the Smoky Mountains in Tennessee. And this is one of the places that I feel most close to God. And I remember a few years ago being down there with three ministers for retreat week. Well, after we would have our days of discussion and study, each evening we would watch movies on TV or the hockey game. But this one night, as I was coming back from the grocery store, we had an intense downpour that sometimes pops up in the mountains. It stopped as I reached the cabin, and as I stepped out of the car, I wondered, who in the world would be setting off fireworks at this time of year, especially during a rainstorm? Well, it turned out it wasn't fireworks, but the hydro transformer had been struck by lightning, and we had no power. Well, we decided to sit out on the veranda, and we were treated to an, you know, the word awesome is often overused, but this was an awesome display. Rolling thunder and incredible lightning, like I'd never seen before. Tremendous sheets of lightning that had to be 5 to 10 miles wide and would bounce across the sky for 40 to 50 miles. It really made the words to "How great thou art" come alive. "I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed." Well, after about 30 minutes of all of us being enthralled by this, when the thunder and rain stopped, immediately the valley below us was lit up with the luminescent glow of thousands upon thousands of fireflies, or lightning bugs, as they call them there. This was a true revelation of God's glory, and we all agreed what a shame it would have been if the hydro had stayed on, because we would have missed the best part of our retreat. God, who revealed Jesus to those three disciples on that mountaintop 2,000 years ago, is still revealing Jesus today, through the scriptures, through nature, through the sacraments, through events that happen in our world. And we need to keep an open mind so that we may truly believe them. Our world is being transfigured. It is being transformed. Most of this has to do with the new appreciation for things that we used to take for granted. As time rolls on and things open up more, how much will we appreciate being able to meet with friends in person? Something we may previously put off to someday. How much will we appreciate being able to go to church on Sunday and shaking hands and maybe eventually even hugging? How much will we appreciate dining in a restaurant, possibly with people from outside our own household, and maybe make a new habit of doing that regularly? Perhaps we've developed healthy habits like walking more, which is especially appreciated by dogs, or we've taken time during the day to have a quiet time with God, or maybe we're just taking better care of ourselves. So is this a temporary accommodation to our current circumstances, or are these real transfigurations that will help shape better lives for ourselves into the far future? We can see that through God, the world is truly changing when we begin to view other religions, other races, other genders, other orientations with caring and compassion. The storming of the Capitol, that showed the worst of human nature. But the awareness and desire for racism to finally end gives us hope that real transformation is underway. God spoke directly to the disciples and speaks to us in many ways. Let's take time to contemplate this week. How does God speak to each of us individually? Let's try to stay alert to hear what God is speaking to us and keep our hearts and minds open so we believe it when it happens. Well, I think it's pointless to try and explain exactly how Jesus' transfiguration took place, because we're never going to know for sure. But we can ask how our own transfiguration will take place. And if we watch for God's revelation, listen carefully, and try to understand where God is leading us, we can experience a transfiguration, and that you can believe, for which we say, thanks be to God. Amen. Well, during this, our offering time, we do give thanks to all those who are watching, sending the links to others who need them, supporting this ministry through pre-authorized remittance or mailing in checks. And if you feel so motivated and you want to do something to help out, then please e-transfer to donations@glenabbeyunitedchurch.com. But no matter what, we're just so glad that you're a part of this church family. God bless you. Let's bow our heads in prayer, please. Loving God, we come together again as a family in Christ on this Transfiguration Sunday, and we thank you for the way that the world is changing in good and positive ways. We thank you for the changes you have made in our own lives and continue to try to guide us in the way that we should go. God, please speak to us. Show us the way, and let us be open-minded enough to hear it and accept it. We think about those areas in the world today that are so in need of your loving touch. We've been blessed. We have virtually everything we need, and yes, we have to stay in more than we want, but we have what we need. And we ask that some justice can come to other areas and people who are more in need than we are. We thank you for your help in touching those who are personally in need but prefer not to be named. And we ask you to lift up those who surround them and give them strength to help them through. And as we go through these days and they continue to linger on, some of us have heaviness in our hearts. Some of us have thoughts in our brains that are not very positive. And we ask that you help with these, that you help us to see a brighter day tomorrow, and that you bring clarity to us. But a lot of times, we don't want to talk to other people about what it is that's bothering us. So we are so happy, so appreciative that you are there to always hear us. And so now to you, we lift our silent prayers. And when the time is right, no matter how you choose, we so look forward to your answer. And thank you for giving strength and consolation to those who are in need, and for helping this church to continue to thrive during these uncertain times and touch so many hearts. Most of all, we thank you that you would come to this world in Jesus Christ, who taught us all to pray together the words of the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our next hymn is another Transfiguration hymn. We have come at Christ's own bidding. It's Voices United 104. Yvonne, choir, please.
True worship.
Well, as always, we thank Yvonne and the choir very much for their hard work in putting together our hymns and anthems each week. God bless you on your mission and ministry. To Rick for your excellent audio-video work and for being able to distribute the service to so many. We'd be lost without you. Thank you. To Catherine Ward for reading today and doing a fine job with the readings. And to all of you for being here as a family in Christ and watching and keeping connected. Thank you so much for that. It is appreciated. And now we'll have our choral blessing as we sing together, Go Now in Peace. After that, the anthem from our choir, a nice postlude, and then I'll be back for the final blessing.
Storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the world is tossing me like a ship upon the sea, you who rule the wind and water, stand by me. Stand by me.
Friends, this understand.
So hopefully you remembered that today is Valentine's Day. Otherwise, that's why you're getting stink eye right now. And you better get on the phone to skip the dishes and get a nice dinner in place. As we go through this week, we look for ways of God speaking to us. We look for the direction that God is trying to move us in. And then if we can do something about it, we can transform our lives to realize the potential God sees in each and every one of us. And we ask that incredibly generous love of God, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the guidance and direction and strength of the Holy Spirit be with us all today and forevermore. Amen. So enjoy Valentine's Day however you can in this very strange year. Have a very good week, and I look forward to seeing you next week. God bless you all. Bye for now.